nations to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If I could ask you to remain standing for a couple seconds. We had a village employee, excuse me, a town employee, Tony Pupor, who passed away, I believe, Sunday. Tony was a great worker for the town, just a great guy. And if we could just give him a couple seconds here to in remembrance. Thank you. At this time, I would ask that you silence your cell phones. And I would call the Village of Messina Board of Trustees meeting for December 3rd, 2013 to order. Ms. Wilson.
Here.
Mr. Offeld.
Here.
Mr. Carmel.
Here.
Mr. Shapes.
Here.
I look present. Closing item one, open number two. Approval of minutes for November 19, 2013 regular meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Closing under two, open under three, reports of officers and committees. Up first would be the code enforcement. And Ken, you were so gracious to provide us with information here. Is anything that sticks out you want to
go over to talk about? Major bullets there. Past month, we met with a number of people that want to. That are coming into the village, so there's new businesses coming in, Heart Haven, downtown. I'm working with Messina Electric. I talked to them the other day. The water billing department and the town assessor are creating a database for the apartments so we can really start hammering on the apartment inspections. We're working with North Country Millworks to get them reopened after their second fire from last month. A couple, three properties that one property's cleaned up and the other two are in the process of being cleaned up. I met with Mr. Sullivan last week about the BDC stuff, the downtown work. Matt Tumper is finishing his code work and Tim Hortons is moving forward, and then there's the what we've done for our inspections and stuff for the month too. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Any questions for...
Yeah, I've got one for Kenny.
Yes,
I can't remember, where do we stand as far as the fees we were going to charge for inspections?
Fire inspections?
Are we all done with that, or are you waiting for something?
Starting November 1st, they're imposed. And it's actually working good. We're sending a letter, and they're mailing them in, and I haven't heard any complaints or anything, so... Yeah.
Last meeting, I brought up... the Novacell property on Main Street.
Yes.
Is there, do you have like any information on that? Like, you're saying paper them.
Well, I know we shared, I think we did a meeting you missed. Haas and I met with her and the property next door to them.
Yeah.
She was present and the other property never showed. She was, at the time, everything looked good and she was moving forward. I know she told us that she was going to try to get the rest of her foundation poured this fall. That didn't happen. She did pick up a building permit. She's got one set of stamp prints, so it's too late. So I guess come spring, we'll go knocking on her door again and ask her where she's standing. So the toss went over, and at that time, he determined everything to be safe as far as the foundation. So her property was clean.
Did you guys recommend recapping? You were talking about putting at least tarp or something to protect that foundation over the winter?
We requested that she put a poly tarp over top of it just to prevent any more moisture from penetrating. And the sheathing is destroyed, basically, but the joist, the floor joist, they're still salvageable. If she covers it up, she'd be okay.
But doesn't it have to be capped? Doesn't it have to be covered per code? Doesn't there have to be something there?
There is. It's there. I think possibly... putting the plastic over it, so that way the foundation itself would deteriorate over the winter. That way she has less work to do.
I think the concern is that she's had over a number of years now particle board has capped on that.
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's been exposed to the weather for going on, what, 5 years now, 4 years, whatever it's been since that fire, or whenever she capped it. Is that safe? Is that particle board safe, being that it's been exposed to the elements as long as it has, in your opinion?
In my opinion, I wouldn't say that it's totally safe. I wouldn't require a pedestrian traffic over top of it. I wouldn't have anybody walking on it. It's delaminated to such a point where it's not going to be salvageable.
Okay.
But the trusses or the floor joists underneath it, they're still salvageable. So what I'm saying is, if they put a poly tarp over top of it, a piece of plastic to cover the whole thing up, they can extend the life of the floor joists and protect them longer, because the sheathing is not going to be able to be used.
Did she provide a timeline, a written timeline or spoken timeline?
Basically, because there was never anything documented, this was our first step. Now this has been documented.
Okay, good.
So I just made a note, I'll contact her tomorrow and ask her what she's doing with, if she's got the poly coming or...
And I mean, you just got to follow it up.
Absolutely.
With timelines.
Absolutely. Yeah. I know we spoke the last week about, you know, winter's here, basically. So,
okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Anyone else? Oh, okay. Closing of the code, open under economic development. We have Tom Sullivan here from the BDC. Tom, if you want to just give a really good thumbnail of what's going on and...
Sure. As many of you have heard, we have a Main Street grant. It's New York Main Street grant still in process. We've sent in 10 projects to the State Historic Preservation Office. We have to receive clearance from SHPO on those projects before you can take it to the next step. We've received, of the 10 that have been sent in, 9 have come back with clearance from SHPO. So the next step in the process is those property owners that had expressed interest in the grant and been awarded grants now are out, hopefully, getting 2 estimates from contractors, so that once they have that information, they'll come back to the BDC office and the local programming authority of the BDC will review those to make sure that they're in compliance and that all the insurances are in place, as far as workman's comp and liability insurance for the contractors. Then we have a pack of information that goes back into the state with an environmental assessment checklist. And once the state has received that, they will then review that, give their approval, comes back to us at the BDC. We notify the property owner that they've cleared the next phase of the process and they can begin construction. And then the construction will be monitored on an ongoing basis, because it's the grant award is a reimbursement, so they have to spend the money up front and then they get reimbursed at the completion of the project, unlike grants in the past where folks had upfronted the money and then they hadn't completed work to the satisfaction. So that's about halfway through. We were hoping we'd get a couple of the property owners moving this fall. It hasn't happened, so probably we'll see some facade improvement on some of those properties in the spring. You read in the paper over the weekend that we're moving ahead with our rail spur project in Industrial Park. We're very confident that that's going to move forward. That will enable Kern Renewable to utilize rail service to move product out. This has been, the BDC has been working on this for probably the better part of 3.5 years. CSX has been, maybe it's the time of the year, a little more amenable to working with us. And so hopefully in January we'll have a timeline of when the actual construction work can begin on that rail spur. So there's some good things happening. The theater project,
That's where Tom will benefit others within the industrial park as well, not just...
Yeah, because part of the design of it will be to have a separate or an accessible loading and offloading area. so that if there's another business in the industrial park that needs rail access, they'll have the ability to access that spur. And there's projected plans of down the road, if we can secure some more grant funding, to move the even further around the backside of the industrial park, so on the south side. So that's moving forward. The theater group, which is a part of the downtown coalition, they have a separate not-for-profit limited liability group that is up and running, and they're in negotiations to hopefully finalize potentially this week the transfer of property on the theater, which will make things a lot more easier for them if they're searching for grant funding, because it would be a not-for-profit LLC as opposed to private ownership. So those are the things on the table right now. So.
Good stuff.
All right. Thanks. And if anybody ever has questions, just give me a holler.
Okay. Anything from the board? Nope. Hearing none. Closing in the Economic Fire Committee.
Been earlier with the report.
Personnel.
Not the report this time.
Police.
And nothing there either.
Rec Commission, you gotta have something.
No, I do not have any, because we have not met since the last meeting, board meeting. What did you see what's going on?
He's always got something, George.
Well, George, hey, bring him up to speed. Was I at the last meeting?
Yes, you were.
Next Tuesday, I'll see you there again, won't I? Amen.
Street committee.
There's something further than that.
Okay. Water and sewer?
Nothing.
Okay. Closing under three, open under four.
Old Man Winter with a 1-2 punch. It's time for a Fisher plow from Frenchie Chevrolet. The new Fisher XV2 plow features extreme flared wings, Fisher's trip edge design, super fast hydraulics, and more. The XV2 gives you both outstanding performance and maximum productivity every time you plow. Frenchie Chevrolet, 255 East Orvis Street, Messina, your Fisher plow headquarters in Northern New York.
If you have a business and need more than just a computer salesman, StarTech is your answer. We have 4 technicians available with over 60 years combined experience for fast, efficient, quality service. We've been serving upstate New York since 1983. We support local and wide area networks, and we service most makes and models of computers and printers. We have a complete in-house service facility, and we offer on-site service to most areas.
StarTech, computer, cellular, and music equipment.
That you keep it under 5 minutes, and with that, I'll entertain any hands. Seeing no hands, closing under four. Did I see any hands? No. Closing under four, open under five. Old business. Before us, we have Fred Mastroni, who's been working with Haas diligently on the aluminum trail. Haas, why don't you introduce Fred? And
sure. This is. Fred is here from Green and Peterson Incorporated from Albany. They are the ones that we retained to design our aluminum trail, that being the footbridge and the walks and the walking system all the way up to Owl Avenue. And Fred here is here today in order to give us a status update of where we are. We are very close to going out, to sending out the documents to have the contractors take a look at that. So Fred will give us a little snapshot of where we are and of our budget concerns.
That's right. Thank you, Fred.
Welcome, Fred.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the village again for the opportunity to work on this project. And very fulfilling for me. It's kind of a unique project. We typically do a lot of highway work and bridge work. This is a bridge, of course, but it's more of a multi-use trail than a vehicle bridge, which is unique. As Haas mentioned, we were selected by the village back in 2009 to work on this project. The original project started at the Pontoon Bridge Road, Olive Street intersection, and extended all the way through to East Orva Street, including some of the side streets of Stoughton Road, North Main Street, Liberty Avenue. Unfortunately, when we first designed that whole system, the cost of it was outrageous compared to what we had available for funding. We were fortunate enough to talk to DOT about the possibility of having the village do some of the sidewalk work, if you will, and new curbing, ADA accessible ramps along the street segments, and then have the contractor do the bridge and also the off-road multi-use trail. And we were fortunate enough to have the project scale, the project reduced somewhat from the contractor's point of view. And I know Hawks has already done some work along some of the streets there, and it looks really nice. The road's done a great job. So basically, the bid portion of the project, if you will, starts on Liberty Avenue at the intersection of Center Street, extends to the off-road trail, which is around the curve, and then, of course, it goes to East Orva Street. Now, from Liberty Avenue to around the curve, we're going to put a new curb and sidewalk section on the right side of the road, as if you're looking towards the river. We had some issues there. Originally, we wanted to put on the left side. However, when we got some mapping associated with the existing highway bond, we found that we didn't have a lot of room on the left side, so we ended up pushing on the right side. And we also are shifting the alignment of that road a little bit in order for us to fit the curb and the sidewalk within the village's highway boundary. So it's going to be a new curb, 5 foot wide sidewalk with ADA accessibility ramps. Then as you get around the curb, you're going to cross the road, and then you're going to go into a multi-use trail, we'll call that. It's a 10 foot wide asphalt concrete surface up to the bridge. Then the bridge we are going to rehabilitate. We're going to, we did an in-depth inspection of the bridge. We found some steel components that have to be replaced. Some could be repaired. And then, of course, we're going to take the deck off, and we're going to put a 10-foot wide monolithic precast concrete slabs. And it's going to, along with the five rail bridge rail, so both bicycles and pedestrians can travel safely over the bridge. In addition to that, the contractor is going to put the conduit in on the bridge, and the Massena Electric is going to put the poles in so the bridge will be lit. So now when you get off the bridge, then there's an existing asphalt path there. However, it's not in the best condition, and because the bridge is going to be 10 feet wide, we need to change some of the geometry, if you will. So a portion of that asphalt path is going to get resurfaced, rehabilitated somewhat, and the rest of it, we're just going to put a new surface on top of it. So all the work is going to be done on the village's highway bond, which is great, because if we had to go through the process of buying some right-of-way, that's another 2-3 years down the road. Unfortunately, it just takes time. The original grant for the project was $1,153,800. And our engineer's estimate, part of the project, because of the cost, we decided that originally we were going to build a parking lot, which we still have in our plans, to build a parking lot off the trail. In addition to the 10-foot-wide trail, we need a driveway to be able to have cars go back into the parking lot or to park there. So what we decided to do is to the parking lot and the signage, if you will, along the trail, make it an alternate bid item. Just to make sure that we have enough funding or we have adequate funding for the project. So the engineer's estimate, which is the base bid for the project, excluding the parking lot and the signage, is $1.15 million. And the signage in the parking lot is about $100,000. So the contractor is going to bid on both segments, but again, it's going to be alternate bid. So the village can do the parking lot, or they could say, well, we'd like not to do it, and maybe the village forces to do it some other time. This coming Thursday, we're going to go out to bids, the village is going to advertise the project, and I believe it's in Daily Courier, correct me that. And we're also going to talk to some of the contractors' associations. Instead of giving them plans and specifications, Foss has a set of plans and specs in front of them there. We're going to put everything on a CD, so that the contractors can print out anything and everything they want. Even the bid forms, you name it, they can print out. I think it's, what we find in the past, it saves money because there's a lot of reproduction work that we're not doing. And I think the contractors, they like to use it, they like working with CDs because they can print the drawings to full size, half size, whatever they want. So that the bid opening is going to be on January 9th of next year at 2 o'clock. And we hopefully will get some good bids back. And yeah, we're looking forward to getting the project completed. Because it's federal funding, there's a lot of, and I'm also sort of very familiar with it, and there's a lot of things we have to do as strings attached, if you will, with federal money. One of the things we need to do is we need to provide full-time inspection of this project. And unfortunately, we need to provide two people full-time because the federal government says anything over $600,000, they don't want to see one inspector out there, they want to see two. And part of the reason behind that is there's been some serious problems in the past with one inspector actually going out and making sure the contractor is doing a good job and then coming back and doing all the paperwork. It's very difficult to do both. There's tons of paperwork that's required as part of the project. So that's, I mean, if the village was doing this project, I'm assuming, awesome, correct me if I'm wrong, you'd probably have a part-time person out there, or maybe one full-time person, but unfortunately we have to have two. So that's kind of the overall scale of the project. I don't know how much more detail you like, but I think at this point I'll leave it up open for... Mm-hmm.
The parking lot is going to be on the north side of the bridge.
Yeah, if you're looking at the bridge from say from Liberty Avenue, it's going to be on the right side.
Okay.
Trail.
Yeah.
And the driveway's on the right, and the parking lot's on that same side. Parking lot and everything else has to be ADA compliant.
Right.
So that's all in the drawings, and then again, it's an altered bid item. We can build it. We don't, or we cannot build it. We have drawings for both options.
Excellent. Anyone from the board?
The folks at Frenchie's Ford know that when it comes to leasing, you want straight answers. Our professional sales consultants are ready to answer all your questions. Now check out this great lease special. How about this new 2014 Ford Escape SE that features Sirius satellite radio and much more? Lease this one right now for 24 easy payments of just $244 a month. That's less than $9 a day. Frenchie's Ford, 216 East Orvis Street, Messina, or visit frenchiesford.com. Ford, go further.
Welcome to Shades Tanning and Hair Salon, located at 108 Maple Street, Messina, New York. Featuring fast, effective, high-intensity tanning in two levels. Relax in the lay-down or save time in the stand-up. Both are available for your tanning pleasure. In a hurry? Try the 7-Minute Sun Capsule, the hottest bed in town. We also offer a variety of hair services, from everyday cuts and colors to holiday and special occasion styles, all at affordable prices. And don't forget to spoil yourself with one of our luxurious, top-of-the-line tanning products. From intensifiers, to bronzers, to after-sun moisturizers, we have just what you're looking for. When asked what they thought of Shades?
I like coming here because of the quality of the service and the comfort of the care, and of course, the good company.
Stop in today. First Tan is free. Or call for an appointment with Joanne at 705-4267. Shades Tanning and Hair. 108 Maple Street, Messina, for all your hair and tanning needs.
Hi, I'm Mike Jones. We're here at StarTech Computer. We have computers, cellular telephones, and music equipment. We do repairs on most makes and models of computers, and we'd like to tell you what we got going on this week.
Smokey here from StarTech Computer, here to tell you about what has to be one of the cheapest cell phone companies around. It's $10 for 4 months with 100 minutes. That equals out to 25 minutes per month and $2.70. Now, I don't know too many cell phone companies that can compete with that. These guys have the same great coverage as one of the leading competitors in this market, so you're not going to have to worry about dead zones or call drops or any of that. And we do sell cell phones here. Some of the phones we have are like this Motorola phone. This is a flip phone. It does have a camera. It does have speakerphone. It is one of the cheaper phones we have. We also have the Motorola Razors. which are nice phones. And we sell the cards here, and we also have other plans here if you're interested, so come on down and take a look.
Now, the way the fence and the standing bids go is it's not a lump sum price bid. It's based on unit cost. If I probably have, I don't know, 80, 100 items associated with the project. What the contractor actually gets paid for is the amount of materials that get installed. For example, if we say, if we estimate 300 cubic yards of concrete for the sidewalk, and it's actually 290 or 310, they're going to get paid for 290 or 310. Not the 300. I mean, the estimate's pretty, we feel it's pretty solid. But just as an FYI, the overall cost of the project, what's all said and done, including engineering, inspection, we estimate to be about $1.826 million.
Of that, Tim, $288,000 was for the engineering portion of it, and that's been satisfied for this day. So the remainder is the balance. The balance of the rest of the
$1.6 left then?
I'm sorry.
About $1.6 left? If you knock the $288 out?
$1.153 is the actual federal funding. The original grant amount was $1,463,172. That's the total funding amount. 80% of that was federal funding, and 20% of that was supposed to be village funding. So that's where the $1.153,800,000 come from. So we have to spend a minimum of $1,463,172 total to be able to get the 80% total federal funding, which is the other number. So if you look at it from an overall budget standpoint, we're at 1.826. The original grant was 1.463 million. One of the things I know I spoke to Haas about in the past, I would like to caution you. If in the future you do request federal funding through a transportation enhancement program or anything that's federal related, I don't know how the original grant amount, I don't know how that was all calculated, if you will, but it'd be good to have somebody with some experience with federal funding, because what we typically find, this is not the only project, we typically find that there's just the grant writer doesn't have that experience, so sometimes they don't ask for enough. And unfortunately, this money's capped. That's the negative, if you will. Some projects, like through the transportation approval program, you can actually get more money if you can justify it. But with enhancement, you can't. It's capped. But just an FYI, I mentioned the Haas. In the future, you guys look for more funding. I don't have no issue just reviewing it. But the positive part is, if you ask for a lot more money back then, perhaps it would have, because this is a very competitive program. I bet you that maybe less than 5% of the project that gets submitted actually funding. So that maybe the other reverse part of that is, if you ask for a lot more money, maybe you wouldn't have got funded. So it's kind of a catch 22.
Yeah. Thank you. How's what were you thinking as far as how many slips we're going to put in that parking lot? Like how big is it?
Let me just turn to the parking lot plans.
And that again is...
Haas, we were looking to make that a park setting as well, right? That's
as an option. No, we didn't plan on doing anything other than putting a parking area down there.
Okay.
They have benches.
Well, that's what I mean. They're picking tables down there.
But again, if the bids come in favorable, we are going to then put that onus on the contractor to construct it. And if it doesn't, if it comes in beyond that price, then we'll end up doing that at some point.
Actually,
okay. Yeah, there's actually seven spaces total, and one is handicap accessible.
Okay. This park you're talking about, that's going to be on the storage street, right?
No.
What's up, Owl? Up the other end?
Up on, across the footbridge on
Richards.
On Richards Street?
Yes.
Where's the trail going to start?
It starts on East Forest Street.
Oh,
right.
Well, you're going to have to park on Richards Street.
In that area.
Where it is down there now, where there's a little park there now.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much a wide open area. I mean, there was a lot more things we wanted to do when we wanted to plant trees and do a lot of landscaping, but we pretty much had a bare bones, you know, and then in the future, of course, the village can apply for additional grants through other sources and maybe get a little more.
I don't want to throw a monkey wrench in the whole thing, but when this thing was first set up, we're supposed to go up to the intake.
That's correct.
Yes.
That was the original plan.
Yes.
Now we're piecemealing the thing here, and this is what we can. This is what we got to work with.
even with this piecemealing, unfortunately, we're still over the original grant amount. That's the unfortunate thing. And I guess, and I got to give, I don't know if anybody here is here from DOT Region 7, but I got to give them a lot of credit because in the past, I've worked on a lot of these typical projects. They say, when you submit your grant from point A to point B, we evaluated it based on that merit of that project from A to B. We don't come back to us and say, well, I'm sorry, I don't have enough money, so I can only do, you know, B prime to C or whatever. And I think between that and the village stepping up to the plate, if you will, putting in new curbs and sidewalks up to Owl Avenue. The reason why we picked Owl Avenue, I kind of sold it to the state because there's a school there.
Okay.
So I said, well, I said, you know what, can we change the project limits to Owl Avenue so at least we can convince the state that it's, you know, kids can walk to school. So they can walk to Owl Avenue. There's an asphalt path there as well. So that, you know. So they bought into it, which is great, and then they sold the fence, which is great. So I guess the good news is at least we can build something versus spending $280,000 engineering fee and then having to turn giving back money because you can't build anything.
That was our impetus too. We didn't want to, you know, we didn't want to just walk away with money left on the table. We're going to try and get something if we can.
Yes.
And I mean, Haas has applauded you all the work you've
done. Well, thank you. Well, you know, he's been a great partner throughout the whole process. So.
Thanks, Frank. Anyone else?
Yeah.
Old Man Winter with a 1-2 punch. It's time for a Fisher plow from Frenchie Chevrolet. The Fisher Extreme V plow takes efficiency and plowing to a whole new level. It features a completely redesigned blade with tapered wing design, gap coverage, high carbon steel cutting edge, and much, much more, providing you with a greater performance and reliability. Frenchie Chevrolet, 255 East Orvis Street, Messina, your Fisher plow headquarters in Northern New York.
Fourth Coast Entertainment Magazine, published monthly, distributed throughout Northern New York and surrounding areas, providing information on the arts, bands, concerts, nightclubs, recreational activities, and tourism. Online at fourthcoastentertainment.com.
Hi, I'm Mike Jones. We're down at StarTech at 260 East Orvis Street, right across from Frenchie Chevrolet. We have computer equipment, cellular telephones, and music equipment, and we'd like to tell you about one of the deals we got going on today.
Hello, I'm Bill Tracy. I'm here at StarTech Music. And I would like to right now point out this bass guitar, which we have on special. But the only way that you're going to get this special is if you come in and say that you saw this ad on TV, and I'll knock another $50 off this guitar. This bass right here is an Austin. It's a 4-string, normally marked $299. But again, like I said, you come in, we'll knock $50 off. Beautiful natural finish with a rosewood neck. Great for a beginner or for somebody that is gigging out right now.
StarTech, where we make things work for you.
Am
me to donate.
Notice we don't get anything for the MED. Not even a calendar.
I've been mentioned three times, and I haven't even gotten up to do my speech yet. So carry on. What's next on the agenda?
All right. Fred, again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We also have in our audience today is Scott Wilson from CECOM. And Scott has a guest that you might want to introduce to as well, Scott.
Tim Harrigan, our Vice President of Marketing Communications.
Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for the village trustees to allow me to come in and just brief you on our project. Obviously, you saw what was written in the Courier Observer, but I thought it was important.
Don't leave everything here in that
paper. I think it's important to kind of lay the groundwork of where we came from to get to the decision we made. This really started back in 2009. We started trending our what we call in-branch teller transactions, a number of people coming in and conducting business on a daily basis. And we've seen a significant decrease like this in the number of transactions, not only here at 79 Main, but all of our retail locations. And at the same time, our business has grown. Since 2007, we've grown 20% membership. Today, we serve about 40,260 of your neighbors. And so when you look at that, there are reasons behind it. And obviously, we go back to direct deposit. It was a day that you came in with your check, you deposited it. Today it's directly deposited, and you don't really have to come in unless you get that occasional birthday check or if your employer still provides a written check to you. So we talked about this since 2009, but then you know all what happened. We had the economic downturn, and it was pretty severe. We didn't really feel it till 2010 in the North Country. We're always about a year and a half economic. And although we have a very flat economy in the North Country, we still saw some significant issues. Obviously, we just came off the General Motors closure, which is a $60 million impact, payroll impact to the area, which is our original SEG, which was the specific employee group we started with back in 1963. For those, we just celebrated our 50th anniversary. So what we're watching really is, just like I'm sure you were all concerned with, was the smelter upgrade of Alcoa. That's a significant employer, more so the significant financial impact it has to the North Country economy. So we're not just in Messina, we're in Franklin County, we're in Ogdensburg, Canton, we serve Governor, and Potsdam, so we have a very regional view of things. So we decided that at the time we recognize we have significant growth, but we don't really have the ability to really expand our operations. We just really simply run out of space. And that really is the catalyst for all the discussions here. So we've hired a couple of people, and we've renovated spaces that would not normally be renovated, but in order to accommodate those new staff people, we've done that. But today we have nothing left. Part of the planning process, we also talked about what growth areas we would have in terms of new personnel. And we project today around 28 new positions in the next several years. It could be more, honestly. And these are average about $35,000 to $40,000 a year salaries. They're all basically back office functions. We are trying to make sure that we put enough personnel in place to continue our growth needs which we have today. So then we have April this year, we get the announcement that there is at least a moving ahead of the smelter upgrade. I think that was positive news for the North Country. And then as a company, we decided that this is probably as good as it's going to get, and this is a good time for us to begin to move forward with our plans. Part of the planning discussion was always a consolidation of our retail branches. We have no other location that has two branches other than Messina. We used to have it in Potsdam. We did consolidate those a number of years ago. And the reality is that you may walk into 79 Main and think it's really busy, but according to what we look at, it really isn't, and it's changed significantly. So part of the discussion was consolidating our operation. Now, we have 35 Andrews over here. That's where our call center operations are. It really isn't large enough for us. We can't expand there. So we've accommodated what we have today there. In 79 Main, we also not only have the retail side, we have back office functions there as well. We have commercial lending. We have deposit operations and card services and those kind of departments. and we can't expand there because we have no more office space. So as we talked about it, we decided that the best option for us was to expand at 30 Stern Street, which we have obviously the availability not only in terms of the building, accommodating the building, but also the land to accommodate new parking and things like that. For those of you who are not familiar, we actually own all the way to the Pizza Hut line over here, and we own this parcel up here. This is all of ours. So in order for our planning, we thought if we could expand on our 30 Stern Street building, we'll be able to accommodate the additional parking we'll need. Because today we just wouldn't have that if we just owned this property. So we talked about going back and looking at all of the positions that were needed. We forecasted those 28. And we also forecasted for an additional 10-year growth for us. So nothing worse than building a building and not having enough room to move forward. So this building will be designed, obviously, to expand another floor if we need necessary in the future. There was discussion at some points, we talked internally, you know, why Messina? Well, this is where our roots are. Some people thought, and I've heard from some of our members, they thought we were closing completely. That obviously isn't the case. And there are other options we are not taking into consideration, and that's one of them is outsourcing our call center operations. A lot of credit unions do that for obviously efficiency reasons. We know, I'm sure you do, that North Country people like to talk to North Country people. You don't want to call Chicago or California. So we're pretty committed to that. We do need space to expand that. Also, the other areas on the regulatory side. So we look at a platform of what you see in the economy. We deal with this thing called the Wall Street Reform Act, or it's simply known as Dodd-Frank. And what that says to us is that we're now under a new regulatory body, including our regulator, which is the National Credit Union Administration, called the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, CFPB. And they're pushing down lots of legislation. Since July, they've added 4,000 pages of new regulation, which we have to adhere to at some point, not all at once, obviously. So we hired we expanded a new department called Risk Management, and we recruited somebody that was a North Country person from North Carolina, from Bank of America. So that created an opportunity for somebody to come back to the North Country to buy a home, obviously, to when they have children, put the children in school, things like that. So one of the other things we took in consideration is that we could wait to consolidate our project. Start our project today and not say anything about saving the name. But that's not the way we do business. I think it's being transparent for not only our staff, but also our membership and the community. Obviously, I've heard some backlash in terms of closing, and when given the opportunity, we've been able to address those questions. One of the questions was, will you have an ATM downtown? We're committed to maintaining something in the downtown area so that after we close our branch, we will have that here. The buildings, I know Mr. Mayor asked me, what are you going to do with your buildings? We will maintain those and pay our taxes on those until we sell them. And obviously, we're not going to just sell them to anybody. Certainly, 79 Main is a very attractive building. It used to be a former Modern Day College Extension. It could use for something again. So the thought was, you know, are you abandoning downtown? We're really not abandoning Messina. We're just going where we can have some growth opportunity. If we had the reverse, we would build here. It is what it is today. So that's kind of what we're facing. It's a 15,870 square foot building expansion that'll accommodate those 28 new jobs, which we need very, very desperately.
Scott, have you thought about where you're going to put the ATM, and will it be a drive-through ATM?
It will be definitely a drive-through, Jim. At this point, those things are in planning.
Okay.
But I am committed, and my board of directors is committed to having something in the downtown for our membership.
Good.
It's hard to take something away you've had.
Sure. Anyone else?
I know you've taken some flack for using a firm from outside of the area. Do you mind just addressing that again?
No.
I know it's structural. And
no, not at all, Trish. The reason we went with PW Campbell, they specialize in credit union space. build credit union branches, they build headquarter operations. They know what our needs are. It is a design build firm. Most, and I say most of the contract work will be done by local contractors. They'll be able to bid on the job. We have a preferred bid list that we'll approve and allow our friends and neighbors who have businesses to obviously to bid on these jobs. Because that was a concern for us. You know, they don't actually construct the building. They just oversee the construction. So that's a little bit of a difference. Not this big company comes in and builds it. Hopefully that answers your question.
Thank you.
No. Just as a closing, this is good for Messina. You know, this is good because that individual I talked about will be able to provide jobs to people who may not be here. They may want to come back, and there are people who do want to come back to Messina. It's a great place to raise your family, and if we're able to do these things, we're able to contribute back to the local economy. And CECOM is still committed to doing all the things we've done. Obviously, we just made a significant contribution to Boys and Girls Club. That will not stop because we're doing this.
I was just going to say the same thing. The fact that you're expecting to hire more people and good white-collar, good-paying jobs, outstanding. Thank you for being a good local employer.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you,
Scott. For 50 years, you've done it.
For many, many more.
Appreciate that. Thanks. Thank you. Okay.
Mark Bogdan, Certified Public Accountant. We here at this office will prepare income tax returns for businesses and individuals. So if you have a C corporation, an S corporation, even partnerships and sole proprietors, we can take care of your tax needs. At the office, we can prepare your payroll and bookkeeping needs. We offer full bookkeeping services and full payroll services, as well as assistance with preparing your payroll quarterlies and sales tax returns.
To Frenchie Selects right now and harvest yourself a real deal this fall on a quality select pre-owned vehicle of your choice. How about this 2012 Chevy Captiva LTZ that features all-wheel drive, leather, and much more, now just $25,900. Or check out this 2013 Chevy Cruze 2LT that features leather, power driver and passenger seats, and much more, now just $21,100. Frenchie Selects, corner of Route 37 and Parker Avenue, Messina, or visit FrenchieSelects.com.
Hi, I'm Mike Jones. We're down at StarTech at 260 East Orvis Street, right across from Frenchie Chevrolet. We have computer equipment, cellular telephones, and music equipment, and we'd like to tell you about one of the deals we got going on today.
Smokey here at StarTech Computer with the GMC Bulldozer computer package. This is a Foxconn motherboard with an AMD CPU. It has a quad-core 2.6 GHz socket AM3 processor. It's 3 gig of DDR2 RAM. It has a 500 gig SATA 3 hard drive, a DVD RW burner with LightScribe, and we're packaging this with Windows 7, a Logitech USB keyboard and mouse, and an iInk 28-inch full 1080p LCD flat panel display. This computer package has 7 cooling fans plus the CPU cooling fan, 3 of which are LED. As you can see, they're red on the case. It has 2 thermal sensors so you can keep an eye on your temperatures, and it has a vertical CD-ROM tray, and I'll show you that right now. Makes this computer very unique. The package is starting at $14.99. If you come in, we might be able to cut you a deal.
StarTech computer, cellular, and music equipment.
Mr. Mayor, thank you. Village trustees, thank you very much for having me.
Thanks again.
SEMA Electric set aside $500,000 4 years ago to look at energy efficiency projects. Now, we had spent significant over $1 million looking at the hydro project on the Grass River. And then we set aside $500,000 for energy efficiency and the sustainability of our energy footprint and our energy usage in this community has been a real driver for the board at Messina Electric. We've spent in the last 4 years $325,000 of the $500,000 we initially set aside, and we've spent that money on a variety of projects. Street lighting, if you drive down Maple Street, those are all new LED street lights. We've done tree projects with Haas, again, Maple Street, Andrew Street, and a number of projects around the town, and we certainly appreciate the work that DPW has done with us to help beautify our community, but it's also made our community more energy efficient by putting those trees in. So we have our motives for doing it. There are a number of other things that are going on that I won't get into of why MED is doing what we do. But we looked at the projects we've been successful with. Where have we spent the money where we've reduced the most energy consumption? And the projects we've been involved with, beyond the street lighting that I talked about, are mostly incentive programs, residential, commercial. We've done a landlord program trying to get people to invest in their own properties. We haven't had a great deal of buy-in there yet, but we're hopeful. Unilaterally, we looked at one of our largest lighting users that we're aware of is the Messina Arena. So we went to the arena looking at what can we do. So I started bringing vendors in there. Rich Beaupre was very nice about it. And every one of the vendors remarkably said they had the best product. And I'm not a lighting expert, so I didn't know what to do. I worked with my board approved spending over $1,000 to write an RFP with Beardsley, an architectural engineer out of Malone, to write specifications that were technology neutral, that we weren't going to decide what kind of lights that were going to be put in. We were just going to demand that it was more energy efficient and that the light quality at the end of the day remained the same or better. The last thing we want to do as a utility is pushing energy efficiency is have a lighting project go in and then have 1,000 fans in the stands there say, you know, 5 years ago when my kid was playing, the light quality was so much better. We for our own motives, we want to have the light quality remain the same or better. By the way, the light quality at Messina Arena is Division I level. And that's we went out there with the photometric equipment and measured. And high school is supposed to be like 30 or 40 foot candles. Division III hockey expects whatever foot candles. Division I is 80 foot candles, and this is 80 foot candles. So it's it's a very well-lit facility, it just isn't very energy efficient. And you're spending about $31,000 a year on your electric bill at that facility, your joint electric bill. Now that isn't all lighting, that's lighting, that's a compressor, there are a lot of things going on there. So anyway, all that is prelude, we went out for a bid. I had a ton of vendors in, but I didn't have many of them bid on the project. I think at the end of the day, maybe they were concerned with how general it was. I think I think some of them were concerned with, we put in a performance requirement that if the lighting quality, when we go back a year after installation, if the lighting quality isn't what it is now, they were going to have to make improvements so that the lighting quality gets back to where it is now. I think that may have driven some people off that they were concerned about the product. We did get five bids from three separate vendors. The spread on those bids was pretty significant. The low bid was $51,000. The high bid was $171,000. Now, let me go back. The incentive programs we run for residential, commercial, and industrial, what we do is we base the incentive on the five-year savings. Whatever they're going to save in electricity in 5 years will match up front, up to $10,000 for or $5,000 for residential, $10,000 for commercial. What we did in the case of this bid, I've talked to my board about extending that because the $10,000 limit we go beyond in this case. I don't, have all of you seen the bid data? I'll pass it around. That's the other thing we did in the bid process was we asked for the life cycle cost. That would be the 25-year life cycle cost. That would be the most fair way to evaluate the project. That, you know, it wouldn't be installation cost alone. It would be installation, maintenance, and energy consumption. So that was all considered as part of the bid. But what we got were two bids that looked at LED lighting only, and then one company bid three separate ways. They bid fluorescent. They bid fluorescent with LED over the light, over the ice surface, and then finally they bid LED throughout the building. And again, there was a, even among their bid, there was quite a disparity from $51,000 to $109,000 to $132,000. So,
Isn't fluorescent cheaper?
Fluorescent is the cheapest, and fluorescent is also the way that Chiel at Clarkson and the basketball arena at Clarkson, they redid, what's the facility in Potsdam State?
Maxi.
They redid all Maxi Hall with
fluorescent.
T5s and T8s, yeah. So that's the way everybody is going, and that's where we've come out.
For 30 years now, Frenchie's Chevrolet has been serving the North Country. And now, Frenchie's has a new look and a bigger and better selection of over 100 new Chevrolets to choose from. Like this new 2014 Chevy Traverse LS that features all-wheel drive, navigation, and much more. Right now, lease this one for 39 easy payments of just $327 a month. That's less than $10 a day. Frenchie's Chevrolet, 255 East Orvis Street, Messina, or visit FrenchieChevy.com. Chevrolet, find new roads.
There's always something going on at St. Lawrence Center. What brings you to St. Lawrence Center? I love all the products and entertainment too. What brings you to St. Lawrence Center? Their prices are affordable. It's my favorite place to go to have fun. There's always something going on at St. Lawrence Center.
Mike Jones. We're down at StarTech at 260 East Orvis Street, right across from Frenchie's Chevrolet. We have computer equipment, cellular telephones, and music equipment, and we'd like to tell you about one of the deals we've got going on today.
And here we have a beautiful Epiphone DOS Studio guitar. This is like a lower grade version of a 335 Gibson. Great for blues, jazz. This is actually Smokey's favorite guitar here in the store. Catch him playing all kinds of blues. And the out of tune Beatles tuning. How's that? I will tune it if you buy it. This guitar is going for, last I remember, I think it was $300. So come in, I may give you a special deal on this one as well.
StarTech, where we make things work for you.
The low bid from Smart Watt Energy, it was estimated that they would have a $4,000 per year energy savings, so that would equate to over a $20,000 incentive from MEB. Again, typically we limit that to $10,000, but at least for that bid, talking to my board, they were willing to go beyond their normal limit. But that's all dependent whether the Rec Commission wants to do it, whether this board and the town board are going to support the village or the Rec Commission going forward. But from MEP's standpoint, we brought it this far along and we're interested in supporting the Rec, the town, the village, and improving the light quality at the facility. And at this point, it should be noted, we're probably not going to be able to do anything. We're not going to be able to do anything until May, June timeframe to get everybody up here and get the ice out so that people can get in there and do their work.
Would the fixtures be similar to what's up there now, Andy, you know, or?
No, they look significantly different. I have some...
If you were to go out business, Andy, even more specific, would you predict that that you'd have less of a gap between the high and the low bidder?
Yeah. You know, intuitively, I guess, yeah. If we wanted to narrow in on just fluorescent lighting. And wrote tighter specifications that didn't leave everybody open to their own interpretation of what to do. I just said, yeah, we want fluorescents here, we want T5s here and T8s there. Yeah, I think people would feel a lot more comfortable bidding it, and we'd get a number of bids. Whether it'd be any better than this, I don't know, but I think you'd have more to choose from, and you could feel more confident about it. If that's your question.
Yes, that was the question. I mean, I'm not really interested in spending a lot more money in recreation than we do right now, but I'm looking at the other side. With less demand, energy demand in the township, it's going to save customers money.
Yeah.
People don't even have children involved.
Right, and that's why MED is doing it. We looked at, like I alluded to before, the residential energy incentive program that we're doing. Every kilowatt we save is costing us 19 or 20 cents a kilowatt. For street lighting, if the street lighting we're putting up works and has the life cycle that we think it does, it's costing us about 5 cents a kW. So it's costing MED's ratepayers 5 cents a kW for that, as opposed to buying power for, incrementally our power is 6.5 cents. Mm-hmm. So it's a good deal for our customers. This would be a good investment for our customers to do this sort of incentive. It would be likely in 3.5 to 4 cent range for our customers to buy into this project.
Now, the annual energy savings right here, you used MEB rates, or did you use?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, what we did, we based it. The thing with the arena, every month we look at when our peak is, when our MED system peak is. And our motive for wanting to lower our peak is everybody saves. So our peak 1 hour costs MED, all of us, we're MED, it costs all of us about $45,000 a megawatt. So if we can lower that peak 1 hour a little bit, then we're all winning. If you look through the winter, we're setting our peak on the coldest winter nights somewhere between 4 and 8 o'clock, because the streetlights are all coming on, everybody's getting home from school, and you know what else is going on? A lot of kids are at the rink. And if we can lower the energy usage at the rink, then you know we're all benefiting. So that was our motive. We're trying to figure out what's going on in that 4 to 8 time period on the winter nights that we can reduce. Street lighting is one of them too.
Now, Andy, changing these T5 or whatever you're going with, is that also inclusive in the annex
and the lobby
areas? And is it all throughout?
Yeah. The lobby, locker room, and over the stands would be T8s. Right now there's a variety of T12s in the lobby and the locker room. Over the stands there's some, I think there are incandescents that are over the stands, but the T12s that are in the lobby and locker room, they're being phased out anyway. And as those things, as you lose lights there and as you lose ballast there, they're going to be harder to find the replacement parts and more expensive to utilize or to gain access to those replacement parts. The ballasts and the new T8s that would be put in out in the lobby are much cheaper. The whole operation is much cheaper. These are probably T8s. I think these are T5s.
T5s, I
thought. What I learned through this, not a lighting guy, is 5 means 5/8, 8 means 8/8, 12 means 12/8. So they're thinner bulbs, but usually the T5s are used in high bay applications. So over the ice, as I understand it, is a more typical use. And what they're doing up there is it's the same length as this. It's just they have 12 bulbs in there. And if you go to Chile Arena and you look at the lights, it's really just a big fluorescent fixture. But I can tell you the folks who work there at Chile love their new lighting system and swear by the energy savings. So that's where we've got it thus far.
The folks at Frenchie's Ford know that when it comes to leasing, you want straight answers. Our professional sales consultants are ready to answer all your questions. Now check out this great lease special. How about this new 2013 Ford F-150 STX Super Cab truck? Lease this one right now for 24 easy payments of just $284 a month. That's less than $10 a day. Frenchie's Ford, 216 East Orvis Street, Messina, or visit frenchiesford.com. Ford, go further.
Welcome to Shades Tanning and Hair Salon, located at 108 Maple Street, Messina, New York. Featuring fast, effective, high-intensity tanning in two levels. Relax in the lay-down or save time in the stand-up. Both are available for your tanning pleasure. In a hurry? Try the 7-Minute Sun Capsule, the hottest bed in town. We also offer a variety of hair services, from everyday cuts and colors to holiday and special occasion styles, all at affordable prices. And don't forget to spoil yourself with one of our luxurious, top-of-the-line tanning products. From intensifiers, to bronzers, to after-sun moisturizers, we have just what you're looking for. When asked what they thought of Shades,
I like coming here because of the
quality of the service and the comfort of the care and, of course, the good company.
Stop in today. First Hand is free. Or call for an appointment with Joanne at 705-4267. Shades Tanning and Hair, 108 Maple Street, Messina, for all your hair and tanning needs.
Hi, I'm Mike Jones. We're here at StarTech Computer. We have computers, cellular telephones, and music equipment. We do repairs on most makes and models of computers, and we'd like to tell you what we got going on this week. Hi, down at StarTech Music, we have a complete line of student band instrument rentals. We've got saxes, clarinets, violins, trombones, trumpets, drums. We have violins, saxes, clarinets, drums, trombones, trumpets, and violins, saxes, clarinets, trumpets, trombones, and more. If you're interested in band instrument rental, the first payment covers the first 3 months. If your student decides to keep playing, all of the rental money is applied towards the purchase. If the student decides not to keep playing, you return the instrument and owe nothing.
StarTech, where we make things work for you.
Thank you. Any other questions for Eddie? I guess we really can't make a decision. Are you considering going out for rebid, Andy?
I'm not sure what's
the question in front of us tonight, Jimmy.
I think it was just more of an informational thing as opposed to just coming to us and asking us.
Well,
that's the way I'm understanding it. Where
the Rec Commission is, the Rec Commission has until the end of this month to make a decision whether to pull the trigger on this bid.
On one of these five. That's scary.
We don't have to rebid.
You can always rebid. Sure.
We don't pull the trigger.
You can rebid. Yeah. At this point, you're not going to do anything until June anyway.
Rebidding would be
the worst thing.
Right. So we don't shoot ourselves in the foot by not going for it right now. In other words.
Right. No. We want to be forced to go through it now. Right. We don't have to be.
Right, right.
Yeah. Bottom line is we've got to come up with $51,000 between the town and the village. 60-40.
If you want to go for low bid
right.
this month, then it's coming up. And I don't know how you work with a board and how we work with three boards here, but that's certainly
it's your 60.
Well, you've been following the paper. We all work very well together.
Okay, moving on. If you want to rebid, Tim, I certainly understand your concern about the disparity in the bids and. The technology neutral idea sounded great when we did it. That's why we did it. But seeing what everybody else has done and seeing where this bid came out on the life cycle cost, there's some things that I would take from the bid process going forward about life cycle costs. But you know, I think Rich Bolkery has gotten more interested and. Has a better idea of what he wants now that we've been looking at this, that we might, if we did rebid it, that we might do some things different.
Have you gone as far as determine like how much of the load is light based versus equipment based down there? Is that, would you guess half and half, or what would your split be?
I guess lighting was 35-40%.
35 to 30. So say if it's 40%, it's 40 and 31K. So about 18,000 a year, then, right? Is about what our lighting costs would be.
Your lighting cost, I think, is about 40% of 31, so about 12 or 13,000.
Right. I was looking at from the other. Well, the other part is 18,000. If that's
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. And that's per year, right? That's a 3 year.
That's annual.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, I guess the question remains, are we going to look at rebidding this to see if it comes in a little bit better than what's anticipated here, or what we're seeing here?
Yeah,
I don't think right now we're in a position to say, yeah, you know, we'll contribute 40% of it.
60.
It's a good thing he's got me here.
I was hoping that would slide. But I think we need to really...
I mean, to jump all over, it's a good idea. I mean, if it can save ratepayers and community money too, you know. I mean, I know he's all over the ISO costs and all the other stuff, and they put a lot of work into this. And Andy wouldn't be standing in front of us if it wasn't going to be a good deal for MED as well, you know.
Sure.
So it's community working together, which is a good thing.
I think it's a good deal for us too.
So the direction you want to go is rebid it?
I think so.
I mean,
we're one of three, right?
You've got
to go with the rec board and see what the rec board thinks and what the town thinks as well.
Yeah.
You know?
So their option would be to rebid it.
Okay.
The town says.
The town's got a meeting tomorrow night, haven't they? The town, right. Their meeting tomorrow night?
Yeah.
And we got a rec meeting next Tuesday. We should be able to tell them if they want to know by December, we should know where we want to go or not. Go out and rebid again. This $51,000 probably will jump up to $61,000. Bid is up based on what it is today. Cost goes up. And if you can save $20,000 of this $51,000 total, you get that in 5 years. That's a pretty good incentive. From what I understand, when it was explained to me when I was down there.
Right.
But the $20,000 incentive from MED, I don't think that's going to go away.
Right, yeah.
And in fact, I'm trying to figure out whether there may be other state monies available to assist in the project. You know, I really don't think you're going to get a bid that's much worse than $51,000. And I think you're going to probably get, as I think about it, maybe you'll get one that's a little bit better, but you're at least from your standpoint, I guess, doing your due diligence, you're going to probably have three or four bids that come in at around a certain number.
Your higher bids will come down.
Yeah.
You would think.
Right. But you're going to have a deeper pool to pick from, and you can feel more confident rather than just one guy coming out with fluorescent. Yeah. I guess it's probably a good idea to take a look to see whether there are, you know, multiple people who can do it.
Could you also say that your lumens have to be, is that the right word for the foot candles?
Yep.
That instead of, you know, coming back and proving it next year, prove it to us now that it's AMD.
They have to do that.
Okay.
And they have to do it in a year.
Next year.
I can tell you right now the rec board won't accept anything, but what we got now.
Right. Yeah, you don't want to go down.
Just for an example, last year Potsdam State needed games to play, and if our arena wasn't that rated, they wouldn't be playing here. We'd lost 7 or 8 games of revenue. So it's important.
But, yeah.
We're going to do it.
And I think I made my point before, from MED's standpoint, we don't want people coming in and complaining about it used to be a lot better.
Right.
We want to have people see that it can be energy efficient and still look good.
Well, we'll just blame it on you if that's the case.
You're going to blame it on me anyway, aren't you?
Or your minion.
Big shoulders.
So, yeah, let's just wait and see what, you know, how it comes back.
Just one board.
Yeah.
But we needed a decision from you guys and from the town which way we could go if we had to make a decision by the...
Right.
Right. So this is good.
Thanks, George. Thanks, Andy.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
For 30 years now, Frenchie's Chevrolet has been serving the North Country. And now, Frenchie's has a new look and a bigger and better selection of over 100 new Chevrolets to choose from. like this new 2014 Chevy Cruze LS that gets an estimated 35 miles per gallon highway and more. Right now, lease this one for 39 easy payments of just $184 a month. That's less than $7 a day. Frenchie Chevrolet, 255 East Orvis Street, Messina, or visit FrenchieChevy.com. Chevrolet, find new roads.
Hi, I'm Mike Jones. We're down at StarTech at 260 East Orvis Street, right across from Frenchie Chevrolet. We have computer equipment, cellular telephones, and music equipment. And we'd like to tell you about one of the deals we got going on today. Here we have an Insonic VFX SD synthesizer. Regular $399, but say you saw this on WNTS TV, come on down, $50 off. Take it home, play all your favorite songs.
StarTech, where we make things work for you.
And machinery insurance policies for travelers. See you later, Drew. I remember doing this last year, so this is the end, I think.
Haas, what are the pieces of equipment that they maintain or that are covered with this with the boiler specifically? I didn't see it. You know, if you can't give it to me now, that's all right. So I was just curiosity more than anything else.
This is the first I've seen this. I'm not sure.
Because it wasn't in the narrative. You know, it didn't list the equipment in the narrative. It was kind of boilerplate. I didn't know if there was specific things that we'd be looking at. It wouldn't be anything in the town hall because that's...
No, I was under the impression that it's equipment that's down in the sewer, water sewer plants.
We have boilers at the BPW.
Right.
I also believe, that the wastewater plant
has
one.
We have one on State Park Station. Okay. So you're looking at, several pieces, half dozen pieces of equipment in it.
Okay.
Very good.
So, do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Very good.
Ms. Wilson?
Aye.
Mr. Offa?
Aye.
Mr. Carver?
Aye.
Mr. Chase?
Aye.
And Chair votes aye. Thank you. Andy, before you go, I just wanted to, if we can switch back real quick. I like the white lights. You've got them on Chase and Ober now, I think, or Chase and Ames, or?
Chase and Ober, yep.
Chase and Ober.
And Maple.
Do you see any of them?
Murray Street.
I'm sorry? Murray Street, yeah.
Yeah.
But I think, talking to Dale, there were three different, have you chosen which one you're going to go with? I thought the Maple Street looked brighter than all of them. I don't know why.
No, we haven't, but I appreciate your feedback. Our biggest concern, we've gotten comfortable with the brightness of the lights.
Right.
The payback on them is based on like a 20-year life.
Okay.
So we'd like to, have our toe a little bit further, or somebody a little bit further out there than us before we spend. We've got 1,100 streetlights. That would be a close to a $500,000 project just in materials for us to replace them all. So I don't want to replace them all figuring that they're going to pay themselves back because they're going to last for 20 years and find out they only last for 7.
So what's your time frame going forward as far as adding more into the community?
I don't know. We don't have a plan. We're going to be talking to the board, and every conference I go to, it's a subject that is brought up. Where people are with them, what we're learning. when you say there, actually we have four different models out there of LED streetlights. Mm-hmm. Three of them are from the same vendor. and between Chase, I think Chase was first, Over was second, and now Maple is third. Between those three, they say they don't even do what they did on Over, let alone Chase, because they learned so much. So that's great. But boy, I'm glad we didn't go all in with the model that we saw on Chase Street. And certainly the model on Over, whichever was first. They're learning so much each year. And even though they're learning and improving, the cost keeps coming down. So there's going to be some point where we're going to dive in and say, yeah, we feel comfortable. I don't know if that's the next 6 months or 2 years from now, but I would say it's not going to be much further than that.
Okay. Thanks.
It's before you start seeing 100, 200, 300 go in instead of 10 or 20.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yep.
Okay. Closing the warrant opener to appointment of the municipal training officer. And he's in our mix today. Ken, you're up.
Basically, I just want to, back in June, we appointed Jeremy as the intern because Dave is retiring. And since then, Jeremy's got his training all through the state, and he's been doing it. And he wants to stay on, so I ask the board if you would formally appoint him to the village MTO.
Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Jeremy, you've done real well with the department. We appreciate your bringing the training in, as well as the other duties. Thanks a lot. Okay, closing under 6, open under 7, vouchers and warrants.
Nope.
Okay.
Yeah, 3.
What?
3.
Requesting. Paul. Oh. Sorry about that. Request authorization to purchase a plow for DPW pickup truck. I'll see.
Yes, the existing plow that we have right now, we've band-aided that thing together for a number of years now. It's about 18 years old, 17, 18 years old. It was originally purchased for the wastewater treatment plant. We welded it so many times that we're having a hard time now keeping it together. So what I'm requesting is that we can purchase a new plow just for a pickup truck, a pickup truck that we put into the fleet last spring. The money was not budgeted for, however, the savings that we experienced with the purchase of the sweeper, we budgeted, I think, $175,000. The net outlay was $149,000, so I think we can purchase a plow with a little bit of that money.
Well, figure 10 years you get out of this new plow?
Well, no, I would figure more because it's a stainless steel plow this time.
Okay.
The current plow that we have is a standard alloy steel plow. And again, it's 17, 18 years old, so I'm expecting at least 20 years out of this plow.
Okay.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Good. Early Christmas present for you, Austin.
Well, thank you, Mark.
Okay. Now, closing at 6, open at 7.
I move that the voucher signed by Trustee Carville and myself be approved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Closing at 7, open at 8. Monthly reports. Thank you, sir.
These vehicles look brand new right off the showroom floor. But they're not. They've been detailed by Final Touch Detailing. If you can drive it, Final Touch can detail it. Trucks, boats, cars, and bikes. It's time to think about getting your vehicle ready for the winter weather. Well, Final Touch Detailing can take care of you. Their services include wash, including undercarriage and engine compartment, vacuum shampoo and steam clean, Scotchgard treatment for fabric, leather treatment, wax and buffing, and much more. Get that car show quality detailing today with Final Touch Detailing. Call 842-9810. That's 842-9810. Or email odie7342@yahoo.com.
Come on into Frenchie Selects right now and harvest yourself a real deal this fall on a quality select pre-owned vehicle of your choice. Here is what you've been waiting for, a 2013 Chevy Volt that features leather heated seats and much more, now just $34,500. Or check out this 2011 Chevy Silverado 1500 LT extended cab truck that features a powerful 5.3 liter V8 engine and much more, now just $26,900. Frenchie Selects, corner of Route 37 and Parker Avenue, Messina, or visit FrenchieSelects.com.